I'd like to bring on our introducer without further comment, other than to say that he's the Chief Digital Officer from the Met, Sri Srinivasan.
Good evening, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. When my wife heard that I was speaking at MoMath, she said, this must be an April Fool's joke. They get somebody from the Metropolitan Museum of Art to come down here and talk about something at the Math Museum. And by the way, you're the only one, you're the only Asian in the world who doesn't know math, so what are you doing here? And in fact, that is true. I don't know math, but I say it with zero pride. I'm actually quite ashamed that I somehow didn't get the math gene that a lot of my cousins and relatives all over the world have had. At the Met, we are working on all kinds of cool things, but here at MoMath, they're doing really cool stuff, and I wanted to come out and support MoMath. I think us museum people need to stick together. Before I came to the Met, and this is a way you know I'm not good at math, I gave up. I worked at Columbia University for 21 years as a professor of journalism and digital media, and I gave up full free tuition for my kids at Columbia to go work at the Met. Yeah, that's the right reaction. She went, wow. And it gets worse than that. It's half tuition anywhere in the world, and it gets worse than that. It's pre-tax dollars. So somebody here will do the math and arrive at an astronomical figure, because my twins were only 10 at the time. But I've enjoyed every minute in the new world of museums to me, but I'm here because of my past. And the past at Columbia included an opportunity to work and think about math and statistics and data. And today, data visualization, big data are things that everybody talks about. But in the world of media, it wasn't something back about a decade ago when we brought John Allen Paulos to Columbia University in the journalism school. And he's written some terrific books, and you know some of these titles. His latest book is called Irreligion, but the next book that he's writing is called A Numerate Life, A Mathematician Explores the Vagaries of Life, His and Probably Yours. But he's best known for a seminal book in the world of math as well as media, A Mathematician Reads the Newspaper. This was named one of the 100 most important books of the century, which is an amazing feat. It was also made into a BBC documentary series and all kinds of other cool and important stuff. And we brought him to Columbia to teach a few years, teach journalists how to think about math, think about science, think about numbers. And the legacy of his teaching there for those few years is that 3 or 4 years of graduating classes of journalists have been unleashed on the world to actually understand math and its importance in our lives. He has gone on to have a wonderful career after graduating from the University of Wisconsin. And among the things that stand out in his wonderful bio are things like he's appeared on David Letterman, and he received the University Creativity Award from the American Association for the Advancement of Science. He worked for 2 years on the editorial board of the Philadelphia Daily News, and he also got to write for ABC, writing columns explaining math and data to everyday people. But I think, as I said, the most important thing he did is teach journalists and media people how to understand these numbers and what they mean. He says that because he worked at Columbia Journalism School, where the Pulitzer Prizes are given out, he has been straddling the world between Pythagoras and Pulitzer, which I love as an idea. And by the way, maybe he'll tell us how come he got to be a question on Jeopardy. I don't know if that's the right thing. Is it an answer or a question on Jeopardy? Those are among the things I'm sure you'll hear tonight. Please welcome John Allen Paulos. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sri, for that very kind introduction, and thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure to be here. And as the slide indicates, I'm going to talk today about the stories versus statistics, or if you want to vary the alliteration, narratives, and numbers. And I'll start, the talk will be in two parts. In the beginning, I'll talk about some general similarities and differences between the logics of narrative logic, mathematical logic. And in the second half of the talk, I'll talk about specific stories, specific mistakes that people make. Let me begin with this first slide. A thousand stories which the ignorant tell and believe die away at once when the computus takes them in his grip. It's Boswell quotes Samuel Johnson to that effect. I always like that quote. And everyone knows about C.P. Snow's Two Cultures, the literary and the scientific. A special case of that is the opposition between stories and statistics, which I'll talk about tonight. And the last line refers to Isaiah Berlin's distinction between foxes who know a lot of little things and hedgehogs who know one big thing. My bias is the foxes. I don't trust people who know one big thing. It's almost always false. But that's my bias. Let me go on. Let me begin by noting that stories, statistics, math, narratives aren't all that different in some basic sense. The formal notions of central tendency, for example, mean, median, mode, and others, grew out of very basic words that are present in any culture. Not these particular, this is English, but every culture, every language has analogs of these words, which are informal versions of these technical notions of mean, median, and mode, and expected value, and so on. Stereotypical, normal, ordinary, usual, and so on. So everybody has a sense of that already. Also, some of the informal notions of statistical variation are also present in everyday language. Peculiar, extreme, singular, deviant, far out. Far out could mean far out in the distribution or far out. And all these terms, as I say, have analogs in other cultures, other languages. Like the Molière character, who was surprised that he had spoken prose all his life, many people are surprised that they really have some, at least intuitive, feel for probability. Probability, the word itself, also has cousins. Chance, fortune, gods, luck, fate, these are all informal words that are refined when you study probability and statistics. But they need a lot of refinement. I mean, many people's vocabulary when it comes to probability is extremely limited. They know absolutely certain. I'm absolutely certain that happened. Or they know 50-50 if they're not certain. Or they know one in a million. And there's not too much you can do with that minimal collection of terms. One way in which probabilistic and statistical notions are formalized are via Bayes' theorem, which you've probably heard of, which is provides a way to revise our concepts in the light of new information. As John Maynard Keynes famously said, when I get new information, I change my opinion. What do you do? Well, a lot of people don't do anything, but you should. But exactly how you do so is provided by Bayes' theorem. Here's a little example here. You have two coins on a table, let's say. One is a fair coin, one is a two-headed coin. You pick a coin at random, the probability you pick the fair coin is, of course, one half. But if you flip it three times and you get heads each time, the probability that it's the fair coin and not the two-headed coin shrinks. But by how much does it shrink? Informally, everybody knows it shrinks. You need Bayes' theorem to actually compute. The answer is 1/9, as I'm sure many of you could be able to calculate. So Bayes' theorem is precise. A difference between the mindset in statistics or mathematics and science is with regard to belief, disbelief. What do you do when you watch a story? The common phrase is you suspend disbelief. It's kind of silly, but suspend disbelief, go with it. But when you do so, if you do it seriously, you risk what's called a type 1 error. Statisticians aren't much for poetic language, so type 1 is what they use. And type 1 error is a false positive. You say something is there when it's not. In science, statistics, whatever, the mindset is just the opposite. You suspend belief. It looks that way, but I'm not sure. I don't want to be confused. I don't want to make a mistake. But by doing so, you maybe have an increased risk of a type 2 error, which is a false negative. You want to avoid both types of errors, but different people are more prone to making different sorts of errors. Continuing in this vein, scientists are conservative, not politically, but in terms of what they believe and what they assent to. And just made up these numbers, but it gets the point across. Conservative scientists predict 4 of 5 crises, and alarmist storytellers predict 10 of 5 crises. I don't vouch for those numbers, of course. Stories, though, provide a context for statistics. They should be added to the standard litany of journalists. Questions, who, what, when, where, why, and so on. To these questions should be added how many, how likely, what's the rate, is it increasing, decreasing, is this the right way to measure this this notion? And there's a totally phony etymology that I've sketched there. The word context comes from the French word for, it doesn't, but let's pretend. It comes from It comes from the French word for story and XT, which are the most common variables used in mathematics. What about this? After his Rose Bowl victory, a quarterback shook hands with almost everybody in the stadium. If I mention that the people, the objections they raise are, you know, quarterbacks are prima donnas, they wouldn't do that, the fans wouldn't wait around. But people rarely make the obvious mathematical point. Even if it took 5 seconds to shake hands with everybody, if there's 50, 60, 80,000 people at the Rose Bowl, the quarterback would have to shake hands continually for days, day and night, and he'd never throw another pass if that was the case. Another example in the same vein, experts fear housing costs, that is the total of rent and mortgages paid in the U.S. annually, will top $3 billion. If I say this, sometimes the people, they'll talk about greedy bankers or the real estate crisis or isn't it horrible you can't get an apartment in New York or whatever. And relatively few people notice that $3 billion is an absurdly small number. 300 million people, $3 billion, you pay $10 a year or rent or mortgage, and people just don't make that point. Or you talk about the number of homeless or battered women or whatever. There you've got to be careful of where the numbers come from. If they come from police blotter reports, for example, they might be fairly low. If they come from academic studies, they might be higher. If they come from the press releases of groups that have an ideological axe to grind, they might be higher still. Or lower, depending on the ideology. So you have to take numbers seriously. They don't merely provide decoration, they provide information. But too often people use them as decoration. I put a number here or there, give the story a little more muscularity. But you know, they mean something. Reference class is something that's often missing in a study. Does a certain person, Waldo, have a certain trait? Well, do you describe him as coming from a certain country where 50% of the people have that trait? Or from a certain region in the whole, you know, several countries where 80% of the people have it? Or from a certain ethnic group where 20% of the people have it? Depends what you're talking about. It will affect your estimate of the probability Waldo has it. Obviously, I just made up those statistics. But and how you present numbers, of course, plays a role in how they're interpreted. HIV rates, let's say you see a headline like this, HIV rates up 60% among South Dakota grandmothers. That's not necessarily alarming. It could be there were 5 and now there's 8. So it's up 60%. It's not serious unless you're one of those 3, but you've got to, you know, report the basic percentage, the relative percentage, whatever. There are different logics that are at play in mathematics and narrative. And in mathematics, everybody knows that you can substitute equals for equals, and everything remains true or false as the case may be. wherever you see a 3, you could put in the square root of 9, or you could put in the largest integer less than pi, or any other of infinitely many characterizations. And if you do so, nothing changes. The truth values remain the same. Mathematics is, in this sense, extensional, as it's called. But in stories, substitution isn't always OK. Lois Lane knows that Superman can fly. And even though Superman equals Clark Kent, you can't substitute and Clark Kent for Superman. And she doesn't know that Clark Kent can fly. Same thing with your wedding day. What if your wedding day happened to be on the 198th birthday of Millard Fillmore? You would sound kind of silly. He said, oh, I get teary-eyed when I think back on the 198th birthday of Millard Fillmore. They're equal, but you shouldn't get teary-eyed at that. Narrative logic is a very nebulously defined field. It's a combination of various other fields, situation semantics, moral logic, action theory, linguistics. So it's not clear-cut. As anybody knows, it's as mathematics, it isn't like mathematics in that it's very vague, subject to all kinds of interpretations, all kinds of slants. And one of the ingredients is, of course, everyday folk psychology, which is notoriously misleading often. But we have to be careful. I mean, we want numbers. We want, when they're appropriate at least, facts, factoids. But we want more than that. It reminds me of a paraphrase of a quote by Coleridge, data, data everywhere, but not a thought to think. And too often, that's the case. We have reams of data that inundate us from the internet, from every place else, acronyms, dates, numbers, and it's hard to make sense of them. We can either have this Baroque approach where everything comes in or a very spare approach as in mathematics, but we need both. We need simplifiers. We need people to get to the logical skeleton of situations, if there is one. And we need complicators to qualify the situation, to provide context. We also have a choice. Do we want a numerical portrait of many people? Do we want statistics that describe a typical person? Statistical artifact often has no relation to any real person. Are there many Dade County residents who are born Hispanic and die Jewish? Probably not, but it is a statistical artifact. Or do we instead want an extended and nuanced biography? Both those things are useful in different for different purposes. Common knowledge is an important notion. Mutual knowledge, everybody knows about. Knowledge is mutual if many people know it. But common knowledge is something more. Common knowledge is not only do I know it and you know it, but we know each other know it. And we know other people know it. And they know we know it. And we know they know it that we know it. And this long train of consequences. So common knowledge is actuating. It's motivating. People act on it. One example is Bill Cosby. Before the recent revelations, a lot of people knew about his behavior, but it didn't do anything until it became known that a lot of people know. Women knew that other women had the same experience and so on. So common knowledge is, as I say, motivating. Lots of puzzles like this. Three boys with dirty foreheads. The mother comments, at least one of them has a mud smudge on his forehead. That's less information than they already have. But if they think it through, they find out that, they all have mud on their forehead. I'll skip the reasoning on that. But reasoning about others' knowledge is essential to many stories. You do it all the time. He knows, Mimi know that Jerry knew, and they didn't want Sarah to find out, so whatever. But reasoning about other people's knowledge is not what you do in mathematics or statistics. Something is true whether Joe knows it or not. Also in stories, private meanings develop quickly. That's certainly not the case in mathematics. There's the old story you might have heard about the one brother is traveling away from home, and he calls home, and he asks his brother how his wonderful pet cat is doing, Oscar the cat. And his brother says, oh, Oscar died. And the brother is heartbroken. He says, why'd you break it to me so bluntly? You know how I love that cat. And the brother says, what do you want me to do? And he says, well, you could have broken it to me gently over a period of days. And the brother says, okay. She went on the roof, and then I couldn't get her off, and she got sickly and this and that. And after a few days, she fell off. And the brother said, yeah, that's how you should have told me. Anyway, how's mom? Oh, mom's on the roof. another difference between kind of probability and stories is the following. It's called a conjunction fallacy. Assume Senator Jones is a devoted family man. He loves his family. He's always talking about his family. He's happily married, and he lives very modestly. So that's what you know about Senator Jones. He's not in the U.S. Senate, but anyway. So you know that about Senator Jones. Given that, what's more likely? That Jones accepted an illegal campaign contribution from a supporter, or he accepted an illegal campaign contribution from a supporter to pay for his daughter's medical treatment, which is very expensive. She was in a dire situation. So which is more likely? One or two? Yeah, it's one. I mean, despite the plausibility of the second clause there, one is more likely simply because the probability of two conditions holding is always less than the probability of one of them. The second one might, the second option where he's accepted the contribution to pay for his daughter's medical treatment may be more plausible. In fact, there's often a trade-off between plausibility and probability. Sometimes when people are lying, often they add extra details. And, you know, it makes it more plausible often, especially if the details are believable, but the conjunction of these is actually less probable. So it's an unfortunate trade-off. And there's lots of other cognitive foibles. I'll discuss a few in the second part of the talk. The anchoring effect, availability, where you are events or ideas that are available, that are accessible to you, are deemed more probable. Confirmation bias is very common. You always look for events, ideas that confirm what you already believe or tend to believe and tend to ignore those that disconfirm it. Unwarranted precision is also very common, as is the 79 million and 9-year-old dinosaur who came about because the guard at the museum said that the dinosaur was 79 million and 9 years old. And when challenged one day by a patron, he says, well, they told me it was 79 million years old when they hired me 9 years ago. So there's the rationale. Coincidences play a different role in stories than or statistics. In real life, they're ubiquitous. They happen all the time. And they're almost all of them are meaningless. In stories, though, people don't generally write about coincidences unless they're significant. They signal some kind of plot turn or revelation or whatever. The most amazing coincidence of all, in fact, it's logically impossible, most amazing coincidence of all would be the complete absence of all coincidences. That's what would really be amazing. Here's some examples. The first letters of the months, January, February, March, April, you have July, August, September, October, November, Jason. Or the first letters of the planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. The word sun appears. Actually, P shouldn't be there. It's been demoted, but it might be reinstated. I don't know. But in any case, is that significant? No, of course not. But it's, you know, you notice it. But these kinds of coincidences occur all the time, and if you look for them, you'll see. The Bible Codes book looked at so-called equidistant letter sequences. You take the Torah, you pick a letter, and you go ahead 18 letters, and you go ahead another 18 letters, and another 18 letters. The letters at those points spell a name or an event that happened in the future. So see, the Bible foretold that event, but that's not the case. If you look hard enough, you'll find it you'll find such correspondences. People have looked in War and Peace, the English translation, or Moby Dick, and find just as many predictive, quote-unquote, revelations. So they don't mean anything, but they're remarkable, and you can get people to think they mean something. There's a little pontificating. There's a chasm between the two cultures everybody knows about. But it's worth building bridges over that chasm, if possible. That's part of what I've tried to do in this, as Sri mentioned, in straddling the two cultures, Philaser and Pythagoras. Let me end this first part of the talk with the story you might have heard about the three statisticians who go duck hunting. The first one takes a shot at the duck, and it goes about 6 inches over the duck. And the second one takes the shot, and it goes about 6 inches in front of the duck, whereupon the third one jumps up and down excitedly, "We got him, we got him." you may have heard of the definition of an extroverted mathematician. He's the one that looks at your shoes while he's talking. There's a guy, a very good mathematician, and he's still sort of a friend of mine, but at Wisconsin in graduate school, he would come up and begin conversations literally like this. "Consider a completely normed Banach space, da 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 da, or consider this Galois group of such and such," with no preamble, no anything, which in a way is nice, but is not common. Okay, different color signifies something. A few statistical mistakes, solecisms to watch out for in the news. Here are a couple of questions, and then I'll answer them in the next slide. Imagine a new medical treatment. A study of it shows that 36% of some group A, defined somehow, improves, but 45% of group B improves. And a different study attempts to see if there's a difference, and it shows that 60% of group A improves, and 65% of group B improves. So the question is the treatment work better on group B? And the answer is it might, but it probably won't, and I'll explain why in a second. The second little question, is there a difference between the average class size in a school and the class size seen by the average student? And is that the case? And as you'll see, or probably already know, there is. Let me go to class size, the fourth item on this slide. It might be the case that this particular school has five classes. Four of them have five students each, and a fifth one has 160 students. So you add 5, 5, 5, 5, and 160, and you get an average of 36 students, which doesn't sound so bad. But if you ask each of the 180 students how many kids are in their class, 160 of them will say 160, and 20 of them will say 5. So 160 times 60 plus 5 times 5, 5 squared times 4, divided by 180, the class size seen by the average student is 142, which is much different. I mean, it's clear this school will advertise the first number probably and not the second. Simpson's paradox shows that you can't always average averages. You can't form what's called a meta-analysis by amalgamating results. Sometimes you can, but studies differ, not only in the quality of the study, the demographics of the people, the sharpness of the researcher, but also numerically. In the example I gave, the first study might have looked at only 100 people from group A and 1,000 from group B. And the second study might have looked at 1,000 from group A and 100 from group B. And if you put the arithmetic together, you get that 636 of the 1,100 A subjects improve versus only 515 of the 1,100 B students. So adding things together reverses the results. There's a lot of well-known cases. A number of years ago, women in graduate school at University of California, Berkeley, sued the school for sex discrimination because they admitted a higher percentage of men than women. But when a university investigated, though every department, not every department, but most departments admitted a higher percentage of women than men. But when they amalgamated the result, men were admitted at a higher rate. And the reason was they applied in disproportionately large numbers to departments that are relatively easy to get into. Another thing about precision, it's very common how frequently you have precise results that don't mean anything. I mean, I sometimes read the recipe sections in the back of newspapers or magazines or online, and they give you very nebulous directions, like add two or three of this and put in some of that, and if you like this, you might put that in, you know, very vague. And then at the end it says, this makes four servings, each with 761 calories and so many milligrams of sodium and so on. It doesn't make any sense. But one, I think the reason it's done is indicated, there's a difference between how people with a scientific background and people without one react to precision. If you tell somebody who has some background in science that this is a number, and you know it to three or four decimal places, people will react with skepticism. How do you know that to three or four decimal places? That doesn't make sense. But if you tell someone without a scientific background, they often take that as evidence that you really know your stuff. Look at you know that to three decimal places. You must really be an expert. So, and the reason for the first line there, pick a random sample, yeah, right, is that you know people say that all the time, but as you know, it's very hard to do. There are all sorts of biases, and you just say it, but it doesn't mean you can do it. Conditional probability, butterfly, and so on. The difference between a conditional probability and its converse is sometimes not noted by people. It's a very common mistake to make. For example, the probability that that someone's a male, given they're a CEO, is very high. If you know someone's a CEO, it's very likely he's a male. But if you know someone's a male, it's very unlikely he's a CEO, right? There aren't that many CEOs. So the converse of a conditional often has a very different probability. It's likewise with cancer tests. The probability you get a positive test, given that you have cancer, might be quite high. But if the cancer is rare, the probability that you have cancer given a positive test could be much lower. You can have a lot of false positives. Most people are healthy, and even a small percentage of false positives will give you more positives than a large percentage of sick people testing positive. And that's why there's been this controversy about mammographies and prostate tests and so on. Because if you get a false positive, it can sometimes lead to surgery, to chemotherapy, to radiation, to at least anxiety. And as are most things in life, you've got to balance things. Billiards, the economy, and the weather, what's the connection there?
Thank you. Billiards tables.
you got it. Oh, I didn't think anybody would get that, but he did. that's a better answer than mine. they're all can be examples of chaotic systems. I mean, let's take billiards. If you have a billiard table, and on the surface of it you have a bunch of round obstacles haphazardly placed along the surface, and let's say you hire the world's best pool player to take a shot, and he does so, and then you offer him $1 million to take another shot that's exactly the same, as close to exactly the same as he can make it. Even if it's very, very close, it'll bounce off that first round obstacle at a slightly different angle, bounce off the second one at a slightly different, a bigger angle, and carry them off the side, hit another one. After four or five bounces, it'll miss an obstacle the first shot hit, or hit an obstacle the first shot missed, and then the trajectories are completely different. So there's this tiny, tiny deviation at first, which cascades into a big difference very shortly thereafter. And that's the hallmark of chaotic systems, the so-called butterfly effect, the butterfly flapping its wings, and a few days later is a hurricane, or maybe more than a few days later in New Orleans. And the weather was the origin of the term butterfly effect. Edward Lawrence studied the weather, and there too, tiny deviations in their measurements led to completely different forecasts after a couple of days, or even a couple of hours, depending on how good their program was. And it's clear that weather forecasts are more reliable the closer they are to the present. I mean, you could probably predict 10 minutes from now, but the further out you go, the less, which makes me wonder why they have five-day forecasts, because in most cases, the fifth day or fourth day is off. And the economy, of course, is connected by all sorts of variables. They're connected in nonlinear ways, and there too, small differences in their estimate of what tax revenue or consumer confidence or whatever will be cascade into big differences. Now, in fact, the right answer when reporters ask politicians about the economy, the right answer is often, I don't know. But nobody's going to say that, unfortunately. There's an easy question there. Why might almost 30% of heart attacks occur between 9 p.m. Friday and 9 p.m. Sunday?
That's 30% of the week.
Exactly, yeah. But I often ask that, and people say, oh, the stress of the weekend, they drink, they drive, they argue with their wives or husbands. But yeah, it's two-sevenths of the week, which is almost 30%. So. All right, conditional probability, the first converse is relevant to the horrible Lufthansa or German Wings crash. The probability that someone who crashes a plane intentionally has serious mental illness is very high, of course. But I hope people don't make the converse, accept the converse. It doesn't mean that if you're mentally ill and you're a pilot, you're going to crash a plane or a mass murderer. So if you're depressed, it doesn't mean you're going to kill anybody. But false positives, I mentioned. Tautologies, literal statements, mathematics is full of them. One thing I like is a fine line. There's a fine line between numerator and denominator. I always like that. And again, I say that to people, and they often look at me like I'm speaking Norwegian or something. Or you hear the phrase, this sells at a fraction of the price. And often the fraction, I think, is four-thirds or something like that. sensitive dependence on initial conditions, fine. Arithmetical blindness, especially when numbers are very big or very small. The examples I gave already, 300 auto fatalities, more than that over a four-day holiday weekend. Again, there's no explanation needed that somebody would die in any four-day week. 4 days, not necessarily a holiday. But when the numbers are very big, it's hard to evaluate. I mean, contamination is a common sort of story. But here's a thought experiment. Imagine a soda can. Imagine the world's oceans, completely pristine salt water. And you take a soda can full of some horrible, noxious chemical, and you dump it into the ocean. And then you either wait millennia, or you stir up the ocean somehow so that this horrible stuff is uniformly spread throughout the world's oceans. Now you go to any ocean in the world, to any depth with an empty soda can, and fill it full of ocean water. Then depending on the molecular weight of the original noxious stuff you put in there, you're going to find thousands, 5,000 to 10,000 molecules of the stuff in this can of ocean water. Yet it's essentially not there. It's a smaller than homeopathic, so-called homeopathic concentration, but it certainly lends itself to an alarmist headline. You know, 20 feet under the Arctic Circle, we found such and such. So again, big numbers blind us. I mean, the Iraq War, for example, is like a sort of contemporary example. Like cost, let's say, conservative estimate cost $1.5 trillion. But you know, people say, "Oh, millions, billions, trillions, so it costs a lot of money." $1.5 trillion. But it's about 200 times the annual budget of the National Science Foundation. It's about 250 times the annual budget of the National Cancer Institute. And oh, that's more money than I thought. So, but you know, as is well known, I mean, people don't react to big numbers unless they actually think about them and put them into context. One example I always liked, I wrote about it in Enumeracy, and it also involves big numbers. If you take a deep breath, you can show that the chances are better than 99% that you just inhaled a molecule exhaled by Julius Caesar during his dying breath. And you know, nobody has a visceral grasp of that. I mean, but it's not hard to show. Increasingly rare events, aging. As we get older, various personal records, the first this, the first that, become much less common, and I'll show in the next slide how that's true exactly. What about that second question? Here's the situation. I give you a deck of cards, and you shuffle them thoroughly. Why, in what sense can it be said that the deck you're now holding in your hand can be considered a miracle? In fact, probably an amazing miracle. Does anybody have any, in what sense might it be the case? In fact, more amazing than most miracles, almost all miracles.
Maybe because the probability of that particular combination is so incredibly small, particular order?
Exactly. There's 52 cards. If you thoroughly shuffle them, any of the 52 can end up on top, any of the remaining 51 below it, any of the remaining 50 below it. And so there's 52 times 51 times 50 times all the way down to 3, 2, 1, 52 factorial, which is about 1 with 68 zeros. There's almost no sequence of events that you come across in your everyday life or that people write about in the National Enquirer that's anywhere near as amazing. One in over one with 68 zeros. It's amazing. But yet, you know, it's kind of banal. You just shuffle it down. Okay, I got this. But almost all orderings of a deck of cards have never appeared before, virtually all. As I said, increasingly rare events. If you flip a coin 1,000 times and count the number of heads, you'll get a certain number. Let's say 506. Next time you do it, you get 420. That's not a record. Next time you do it, you get 514. That's a record. Next time, 482. Next time, 503. Next time, 521. The records come ever less frequently. And you can show that the number of records up to a point n decreases with the log function. So and the relevance of that to weather is that in weather records are not decreasing in that way. Weather records are occurring more and more frequently, but they should, if weather were kind of uniform, be occurring equally frequently. And the reason they're not, of course, is despite Senator Inhofe, the chairman of the House, the Senate Environmental Committee, climate change is real. I tweeted today that he should announce a kind of, Senator Inhofe, who thinks global warming is a hoax, he should announce today a kind of reverse April Fool's joke and say that he thinks climate warming is not a hoax. And tomorrow he can go back to it being a hoax. mean versus median, common terms, I mentioned them earlier. Mean is just the average. The median is the middle number, half less than it, half bigger. But the median, big numbers have an effect on the median, of course, but not on the mean. So if you have a neighborhood where Bill Gates and Warren Buffett live, and it's a very poor neighborhood, the mean income, the mean house price would be very high. The median income, median house price would be very low. In fact, I mean, political parties differ. At least arguably, Democrats would stress the median. Republicans are more likely to stress the mean, but they should at least know these two terms, and often people don't. The multiplication principle is a simple idea that has lots of consequences. If you can do something in certain x different ways, and you can do something else in y different ways, then you can do them in succession in x times y different ways. And you can iterate. If you do 10 tasks, first in x ways, next in y, next in z, and so on, the number of ways of doing them in succession is their product, hence the name multiplication principle. So numbers grow very rapidly, like the card deck. 52 factorial is about 10 to the 8th. And most people don't realize how fast they grow. Likewise, probabilities shrink rapidly when you're dealing with independent events. If events are independent, the probability they all occur is the product of their probabilities, and probabilities are numbers less than one, so when you multiply them together, the product shrinks very quickly. What about this middle question? Are there more words beginning with K or words with K as the third letter? And why? or what's your guess? Anybody? More words, English words beginning with the letter K or having K as the third letter?
I'm going to guess that with the K as the third letter.
All right,
just because I know that K is rare as a first letter.
Yeah, it's not that rare as a first letter, but it is. And I mean, the thing is that this is an instance, illustration rather, of the so-called availability heuristic, whereby we think events that come quickly to mind, that are accessible, that are available, are more probable than they really are. And it's easy to think of words like, you know, kitchen, kite, whatever, and hard to think of words that have K in the third position. I can think of awkward. What are some more? Awkward's the only one I can think of. What? Cake, fake. Part? Arc? Okay, yeah. I was thinking mathematically, arc, yeah, okay. Yeah, okay. All right, see, this is the myopic nature of being a mathematician. Arc is that, huh? Okay, I don't like the other, anyway. Your favorite example of a coincidence, is it specific or generic? It's probably specific, and people always ask, you know, what's the probability of this particular thing? And they give me some amazing thing that happened in their life. And the answer is almost always tiny. Yep, you're right, the probability of that is tiny. But the right question isn't that. The right question is, what's the probability of something of this general sort occurring? And the probability of that is almost always very high. Not the probability of this particular event. Any particular event has small probability. But the probability of an event of something vaguely similar. And it's hard to define vaguely similar. But still, that's going to be much higher. Does 2 and 2 always equal 4? It's back there. What's an example?
If you're in a tertiary system, then 2 plus 2 is 1, 1.
Okay, that's one way, yeah. Is there another way in which 2 and 2 can fail to be 4?
2 and 2 could be 22, not always 4.
Okay, that's another way. What about a physical example?
2 fathers and 2 sons give you 3 people.
Say that again?
2 fathers and 2 sons will give you 3 people.
Okay, all right, okay. What the example, one kind of example I had in mind is if you take, it's not unique. You take 2 glasses of water, let's say, and 2 cups of popcorn, and you mix them together, you don't get 4 cups of soggy popcorn, you get about 3 cups. So, I mean, the assumptions you make the physical assumptions you make are important. I mean, mathematically, 2 and 2, despite those other examples, is always equal to 4. But if it becomes not pure mathematics but applied mathematics, then that's not always the case. So, as I mentioned about coincidences, Oh, that last line under coincidence, recognizing randomness is difficult. And I often give my classes the following assignment. To half the class, I tell them to go home and flip a coin 100 times and record the sequence of heads and tails. And to the other half, I say, go home and write a sequence of H's and T's, a 100-character sequence of H's and T's that you think looks random as you can make it. And then I have them hand them in, and about 90% of the time, I can tell a difference. And the reason is, if you flip a coin, coins don't behave in the way most people think randomness should behave. You get lots of runs. If you flip a coin 100 times, you're very likely to get 6 heads in a row, or 6 tails, or 7 heads. And if you're making up what appears to you to be random, you won't put that in. So it gives you long runs, frequent runs. Also, it gives you infrequent changes in the lead. If you flip a coin, I won't assign my class this, but if you flip a coin 10,000 times, sorry, class, and you keep track of which is ahead along the way, heads or tails. If you have more heads up to a certain point, heads is ahead. If you have more tails up to that point, tails is ahead. And you keep track as you go along, which is ahead. It's much more likely that one or the other will be ahead almost the whole time. I mean, even though on average you'll have 5,000 heads and 5,000 tails, but one of them will be ahead almost the whole time. And that seems counterintuitive. And so it's difficult to recognize randomness. And that's one of the reasons people swear by technical analysis. Oh, I did this, and head and shoulders, and whatever. And it seems like it works, but it doesn't. The anchoring effect, I talked about these other biases a bit. The anchoring effect is kind of amazing. Here's an experiment that illustrates it that's been done many times. I've done it in my classes. You ask a large group of people, like this group, what's the population of Turkey, a country about which they probably don't know much. But you say, wait a minute, before you tell me, first tell me if it's more or less than 7 million people. And most people will say, I think it's more than 7 million. I mean, they write down privately on their little piece of paper, more. And then they give their guesses. And their guesses might range around 20, 25 million. You ask a different group of people, totally different people, same question. What's the probability of Turkey? But wait a minute, before you tell me, is it more or less than 240 million people? And most people write down less than 240 million people on their little piece of paper privately. They're not influencing each other. It's all private. And their guesses as to the population of Turkey will vary, but this time they might average 180 million people. So they're anchored to that number that you're given. But what's really astonishing is if you ask a third group of people, what's the population of Turkey? And then you whip out a little spinner with a dial and numbers around the periphery, 3 million, 7 million, 240 million, whatever. So a bunch of numbers around the outside. And you say, what's the population of Turkey? But wait a minute, before you tell me, is it more or less than this number? And you spin the dial. And the astonishing thing is that the same effect occurs. If a big number comes up on the dial, they'll guess a big number. If a small number comes up on the dial, they'll guess a small number. And in the first two cases, there's a rationale. They might think to themselves, I don't know anything about Turkey. This person presumably does. Maybe it seems a little low or a little high, but it's probably close. But clearly, the dial doesn't know anything about Turkey. And it's kind of I've done it, it's kind of an unnerving thing. It can be used tendentiously. If you want to raise money for whatever you think is some disease that's rare, just exaggerate how common it is. And by the time people catch on, you'll have raised money. Oh, the population of Turkey, I don't even know. I think it's about 70 million. But I don't think we have internet access down here, so I can't check. Intimidation by math. I mentioned these other examples. Let me mention one more about the tribe of bear hunters that went extinct soon after they mastered vector analysis. And the reason was they hunted bears with their bow and arrow. And when they spotted a bear to the northwest, they would shoot an arrow to the north and one to the west, and the bear would get away. But in all these cases, I mean, two and two is four, duck hunters and so on, they're kind of silly. But the same kinds of mistakes are made when the mathematics is very esoteric. It's just that people don't recognize the silliness of what people who are using them say. Not always, obviously. In fact, hopefully not most of the time. But nevertheless, often, you have a very esoteric bit of mathematics behind which you can dance around and nobody really knows what you're talking about. Differing risk perceptions, what's that question? What's the answer? What do you think the answer to that question is? Why do we elect so few scientists in the United States? There's no right answer, just why do you? Does anybody have any guesses? Hi, here.
So few run for office.
Yeah, but why do so few run for office then? I mean, the people who do run for office are by and large lawyers. I mean, it'd be nice if the complexity of scientific issues was addressed by someone with technical background. As I mentioned, Jim Inhofe is chairman of the Science Committee. Representative Brown from Georgia used to be the head of the House Science Committee. He's the guy who said that evolution, the Big Bang, relativity, whatever, are all ideas from the pit of hell. And he was the chairman of the House Science Committee. So, I mean, I think scientific abstract approaches to issues run afoul of cultural, religious issues. And, I mean, climate change is one of them. I'm sorry?
Americans, in general, aren't fond of
bright people. Yeah, right. I mean, I've often heard, I mean that there isn't one word in favor of cleverness in the whole Bible, which I think that's probably true. I don't know. I'd like to see it if there is. But it's also the Americans' view of scientists, mathematicians is very bifurcated. I mean, on one hand, lots of Americans revere science, scientists, mathematicians, oh, it's wonderful, but at the same time dismiss them. They're impractical, they're pointy heads. So, I mean, I think it could do with less reverence and more taking seriously. But let's see, what was I gonna say? I mean, other countries do. I mean, Angela Merkel, has a PhD in physical chemistry. Singapore has got a lot of mathematicians, scientists in the government. But it's not a panacea. I mean, Herbert Hoover was, I think, had a degree in engineering. Ted Cruz is supposed to be, I mean, Alan Dershowitz said Ted Cruz was the smartest law student he ever had at Harvard, which I find hard to believe, but. what about this? The second question? Again, given the way it's phrased, I'm sure you can guess the answer, but to explain it. Can a candidate for president receive 11 popular votes and his opponent receive 100 million votes and yet still win?
I misread it. Are you asking if the first candidate?
The first candidate gets 11 popular votes, the second candidate gets 100 million, but the first candidate wins.
It's exceptionally implausible, but if the first candidate gets 11 votes in California and nobody else gets any, and the second candidate gets 100 million in Delaware and nobody else gets any, then the first candidate gets, 53 electoral votes from California, and the second one gets 3 or 4 from Delaware? Yeah, right. And since nobody else was running and nobody else cast any vote in the entire country, the first candidate has to win.
I think you need 270 electoral votes. I mean, I think that's the right idea, but
So if only one person votes in the largest states,
in each of the 11 largest states,
and nobody else, and they win each of those,
right,
and everybody else votes everywhere else, Right.
Then
you could do it.
Yeah, so you take
it is implausible.
Right. California, New York, Pennsylvania, the vote is 1-0, and every place else. I mean, it's totally implausible, but a more plausible version is that you can lose the popular vote as Bush did in 2000 and yet win the electoral vote. And that wasn't the only time that happened, which is one reason people want to abolish the Electoral College. Health risk perceptions. I mean, everyone knows people differ in their risks. I mean, people are afraid of things they don't have to be. They're afraid of sharks, right, Theo? Afraid of sharks. Plane crashes versus obesity. I mean, plane crashes are easy to imagine. I mean, it's not in your control. There are a lot of psychological factors. It's not in your control. It's very vivid. It's very dramatic. It's easy to put yourself in the place of the passengers. Carcinogens versus sugar. People are afraid of carcinogens. Sugar probably kills more people. Climate change, I mentioned. The vaccines, people are afraid of them. There's a parody of American Family that comes to mind when I think about this. And that is, I imagine this family is driving down the highway, New Jersey Turnpike, and they're going 90 miles an hour, and they have two kids in the front seat standing up between them and not belted in. And the father is smoking, and the mother is drinking whiskey, and they're talking about the risks from pesticide residue on grapes. That is too often the case. I mean, you don't put risks into perspective. A couple things on voting, and I'll be done. There's a difference between power and votes, and one way to illustrate this is the following example. Imagine you got a company with three stockholders. One of them has 49% of the stock, the other 48%. And a third 3%. And a majority is needed to pass or reject the measure. Then even though one of them is much poorer than the other two, they all have the same power because you only need two out of the three to vote for something to pass. 48 and 3 is 51. It's fine. Contrast that company with a different company that has four stockholders who own 26, 27, 25, and 22% of the vote. Then this is a more uniform distribution of the stock. No one of them is much poorer than any other. Yet the fourth stockholder, the one who owns 22% of the stock, is powerless. His vote never makes a difference one way or the other. If any two of the first three vote for something, it passes. 26 and 27 is 52, 26, 25, 51, and so on. So adding his vote to two of those three won't make a difference. But to just one of them, 27 and 22 is 49. So even though there's a more uniform distribution, the fourth stockholder's got no power. So there's a difference between power and the votes. It's why small political parties, for example, have a lot of power sometimes, depending on the configuration of the other parties. Finally, let me make a confession or apology about my unintended role in getting George Bush elected in 2000. Or some of you might congratulate me, I don't know. But how did that happen? After the vote in Florida, before it was decided, I wrote an op-ed for the New York Times in which I talked about the hanging chads and the confusing ballots and the miscounts and the military ballots and all of the various issues that plagued the election in Florida. And there were 6 million votes counted. The difference between Bush and Gore was 500 votes. But I said that essentially there was no fact of the matter, that the margin of error was greater than the margin of victory. And it's a little bit like trying to measure bacteria with a yardstick. I mean, the apparatus is just too gross for what it was trying to do. And okay, that's fair enough, I guess. But then the recount was brought to the Florida Supreme Court, which voted to extend the recount, which might have involved, you know, which might have given Gore a 50-50 chance of winning if they recounted. But the head of the Florida State Supreme Court cited my article. He says, as John Allen Paulos wrote, that there's no fact of the matter. And what's the point of extending this and generating more rancor and divisiveness and whatever? There's no fact of the matter. Here's what it is. That stopped. And so they didn't. They didn't recount. The Florida Supreme Court did not vote that way. It went to the Supreme Court, and it was, you know what happened. So. In that indirect way, I was a butterfly that led to George Bush's election. Anyway, let me end with this little graph. It's a journalistic pie chart. And it too often expresses the way issues are handled in the news. But anyway, let me stop there. I'd be happy to entertain any questions or comments or whatever. Thanks.
So if you feel you could use a little mathematical help in reading the newspaper, here's how it works. Just raise your hand. I'll run over to you with the mic, wait for it, stand up, ask your question with the mic, and then sit down and we'll hear what Professor Paulos has to say. So anyone has something they would like to know more about? Right here.
So early in the talk, you talked about the importance of, I guess, putting numbers in context and merging the narratives and the numbers.
Right.
Whose job do you see that to be? Is it just journalists, or do mathematicians, you know, they have a role in all this?
No, I think, journalists should be literate. I mean, as Sri said, I did teach a course. I mean, I'm in the math department at Temple, but I did teach a course for a year on quantitative literacy. And the students were very bright, very verbal, but they were innumerate, and it was, unfortunately, it was easy to fool them. I mean, any little trick, quirky way of presenting things did. And I found that a little depressing because they were going to go out and interpret the world to this booming, buzzing, complicated world to everybody else. But no, it's not only the job of the journalists. It's the job of scientists. Even though American scientists do write more for a popular audience than scientists in any other country, it's still the case that they don't reach out as much as they could. It'd be nice if more scientists were elected, which just doesn't mean that it's a panacea. But no, it's everybody's job. But I think, I mean, always framing things in a polarized sort of way, and maybe having, I don't mean to dump on lawyers, my son's a lawyer, but always having, you know, approaching things legalistically and not looking at the facts is part of the problem. But you know, everybody is to some extent responsible, and it is. I mean, it's kind of a cliche, but I think it's a cliche for a reason. I mean, the United States does have a kind of long history of anti-intellectualism. And even just talk about being exceptional or exceptionalism. Yeah, in many ways, but in lots of ways that have to do with facts in the world, how could we be exceptional? We're not. Our DNA is the same. I mean, and we're subject to the same climate as the rest of the world. So I sometimes think this talk of exceptionalism is counterproductive. I mean, it makes people think, oh, we don't have to play by the rules because we're Americans. And
they stand.
My question at root may be no more mathematical than his, but it is about numbers and it is about a public issue. And I'm wondering if you would have a perspective on it from a numerical, mathematical standpoint. Personally, I don't think it is. It's political. But the debate about the unemployment rate and whether it's proper the way they measure it, and even, you know, some people say it's a conspiracy to fake the unemployment rate for political reasons. I'm just curious whether, you know, as a as a quantitative thinker, you see any mathematical, you know, angle to look at that controversy over how the unemployment rate should be stated or measured or whatever?
Well, I mean, it depends on, obviously, on what you mean by unemployed. Do you count people unemployed for a long time? I mean, there are different ways to tote up any complex quantity, and but generally, we've been using the same method for a long time. It's not that there's a conspiracy. I mean, you can look at other factors like long-term unemployment, but I don't think there's any great conspiracy.
Speaking of estimating large quantities, if you had to estimate, for example, the percentage of New Yorkers that have iPhones, and it was very important that you were as accurate and as unbiased as possible, how would you truly get a random sample of all New Yorkers?
A random, what percentage of New Yorkers have iPhones?
Just as any parameter, anything. Just how do you take a truly random sample of a population of unknown size, exact size?
Well, it's difficult. I mean, there's something called stratified sampling. I mean, people know that there are so many people in different categories, and they sample from each of the categories proportional to their respective sizes. But even random sampling within a category is different, and I mean, it's difficult, and you know, everybody knows the problems with telephone sampling, and go back to Dewey and so on. But I mean, there are better and worse random samples. I mean, some are clearly, you don't go to a gun range to sample opinions about gun control. So you can avoid the extremes. But you can make efforts. Stratified sampling is one of them. And then within that, you pick people and you actually pay people to go and not take no for an answer. But that's very expensive. So every once in a while, you do that and to get a baseline so that when you deviate from that, you have something that you can point to what you did once and actually send people to, wrestle people to the ground. Tell me, do you have an iPhone?
How do you feel about the words statistically significant, and what do you think we should take away as lessons about hypothesis testing?
Well, statistically significant, as most of you probably know, does not mean significant. In any basic sense. I mean, you can have a huge study of a certain medicine, and if the study is so huge, the percentage of people who feel better might be 0.01, and so it doesn't make any difference practically. But the study is big enough, so it's statistically significant. As far as the other problem is, statistical significance, p-values, people. No, there are objections to that, which are kind of technical. So I'll want to beg off and not annoy one faction or other.
How have prospective medical students or practicing doctors been changing or not over the years in terms of their ability to measure false positives, false negatives, et cetera, accurately?
Well, medical doctors, in my opinion, aren't all that numerate. I mean, there are studies that have been given. They give you, some facts about some tests, the mammography, and they say, false positive rate is this, a false negative rate is this, the rate of this kind of cancer is that, and somebody tests positive, what's the probability they have cancer? And they usually go with, if you have cancer 98% of the time, the test will be positive. So you test positive and say, you'll have cancer 98% of the time. So they switch the conditional probability from one thing to its converse. And doctors notoriously get that wrong. Actually, an anecdote I think I mentioned in, I forget what book, but it's a true story. A number of years ago, I went to a doctor. My wife went to a doctor, but I accompanied her. And it was some minor procedure he was considering. And she was a little bit nervous. And he said, don't worry, there's a 1 in a million risk associated with it. So she felt better. And then a little bit later during this consultation, he says, don't worry, it's 99% safe. And but it gets even worse. As we go out the door, he says, it usually goes quite well. with no sense of irony, no sense of how he was changing by orders of magnitude his estimate of the risk. So.
All right, on that note, while it's still safe, let's thank our speaker one more time.
Okay, thank you.